So again, social marketing is influencing target audience behaviors that benefit society. And the lessons, as I said, came from the public health arena. Social marketing has five basic tools. And if you've been, have any of you been at Keep America Beautiful sessions in the last couple of years when they talked about this? It's like new territory, I think, one or two people. When Keep America Beautiful comes out and does their talks now in local communities, they will talk about these tools a lot and how to implement them and what the pros and cons are. I'm just going to go over them very briefly. The first is commitments, and one of the best examples of that is the annual America Recycles Day pledge drive. You're asking people to make a pledge. Even KAB will tell you about that. The most effective way to make that pledge is to have people be in a local action that other people can see. Those are the pledges that are going to have the strongest effect. So that's one. Incentives would be another. And the problem with incentives is, and this might be, we're going to randomly check cards, and if we find a clean card, we're going to put you on a list, and you're going to win a prize, or you're going to win a prize in your neighborhood. The more random that incentive is, the more likely it is to be effective. It's kind of like if any of you have mothers or grandmothers that love the Publishers Clearing House giveaway, the uncertainty or the thought that Ed McMahon really was going to one day show up at their house got them to keep entering. So an incentive that is random is going to generally have a little bit longer lasting effect than one that isn't. But incentives are often a good way to get new people started with your program. You won't necessarily keep them, but you can use some of the other tools to do that. Prompts are another. Signage is a wonderful example of a prompt. A sign is a prompt. Calendars or prompts, anything that is reminding people to take action. The recorded telephone message, the bill, the line at the bottom of the bill. All of those are prompts. A prompt is nothing more than a reminder. So the more ways you can get out there, the better. Social norming is the one that has the most long-term effect, and there is a wonderful example going on around this whole country in social norming. It is those carts being put out every week, because what happens is you drive down the street and you think, am I the only person in my neighborhood that doesn't put out this cart? Well, you don't want to be the only person in your neighborhood that doesn't put out their cart. So then you start thinking, well, what am I supposed to put in this cart? That creates a norm. Now, the downside of a norm is if you are the overachiever, a norm that you start to notice not as many people are doing this, you'll tend to kind of sink to the average. So a norm can be a negative for an overachiever, but for an underachiever, a norm is a very powerful thing. Teenagers are not the only ones who are susceptible to peer pressure. So we're adults. And then giving people feedback. The best feedback is personal. The problem is, unless you have a very complex system on your carts for measuring what people, most of us don't have a way to do that. So the closer you can get that feedback to that person in your neighborhood, their city, the better. The closer the feedback is, and the closer in time the feedback is to what happened, and the more specific it is. So those are the five basic tools of social marketing. The idea is that with them, you will achieve what is called social diffusion, which in real terms is what we all think of as going viral. You want the behaviors to go viral, and you use these tools to get there. Core to anything, and this is the mistake that I think sometimes we all make now, is we think, oh, there's all these wonderful media choices, content doesn't matter anymore. I don't know if y'all remember, some of you are way too young to have been through the experience of developing your first website back when there were no websites. And you would work with these developers, and they're like, why do you care about typos? I mean, nobody cares about that on the internet, you know? And was at the beginning, this wild, kind of like social media is now with all the acronyms. And eventually what people realize is no, content still really matters, no matter what you're doing. So the even if you're using these new tools, you're using prompts, you're using incentives, even if you're thinking in terms of the new tools, at the center of that is still having good, reliable content. So the first is that your information needs to be clear. And I like to think of this in terms of frequently asked questions. What are your frequently asked questions? What is that information that you get asked over and over and over again? Make sure that anything you are developing, whether it's print or written or spoken, answers those questions. Make sure that the instructions are as easy as possible to follow and that you're using common terms. I just had a client do this week. Okay, well, they are really far away from here since they are not in this room and will remain nameless. But they wanted to put that one of the things they don't accept is heat, chemical, paper, which I think means like register tapes that are printed from a certain type of machine like the old fax machine. I'm going to point out to them when I send them their final to approve that even I'm not exactly sure what they don't want in the bin based on that, that we need to come up with a better term. So make sure you're using a term that would be meaningful to people in your community. And that will change locally. Chipboard and paperboard in the world of what goes into a single stream bin are the same thing, but they are not common terms in the same parts of the country. So you need to know what your terms are locally. The other thing, single stream is one of my favorites, by the way. Single stream, when you say that to a normal person, they think you're talking about rivers, what goes to the ocean, and they have no, you're like, we're getting these single stream carts. Okay, don't understand that. If you say to them, mix all of your recyclables in your cart, don't use the term single stream at all. That's an insider term. They don't understand it. They don't need to know it. It doesn't matter to them. So, and then make sure it's always simple for them to get more information from you. Your website, your phone number, email. However you would like them to find more information, make sure every single thing you do has that in an easy-to-spot place. And then, kind of like, I'm going to talk about action verbs, since you covered fonts, one of my favorites. If you want to, afterwards, we can talk about write it right versus full justification, too, because I have a lot of opinions about that. Write it right is much easier to read for the average human being, and avoid the caps, please. So, but action verbs are very important. These sentences say basically the same thing. One has an action verb, one doesn't. Is not an action verb. Wake up is. So the great thing is we work in a field where our main terminology is action verbs. Reduce, recycle. Those are action verbs. So think in those terms when you're writing. And then this should be obvious, but make sure your program information is up to date, especially your website. I know websites are very old school, but if someone goes to your website and they find out, they look and they say, gosh, the last thing they posted here seems to be dated 2008, they're not going to come back because they're going to assume that what they saw there was out of date. Now, maybe that was the only thing that was old, but look at everything you've got posted with an eye to how old is this information. And if you have a Facebook page, that means if you've posted some photos in the past, you better keep posting, because otherwise all the albums you have posted are going to look very old. So keep that in mind too. Purge outdated information. Obviously this is not something on social media. The way you purge outdated information on social media is by posting new information, which you want to get to enough. And then make sure it's updated regularly. Make sure someone is responsible for updating it. That's one of the things that happens sometimes, is it's nobody's job. And so what happens is it's not out there. I would also say on websites, because I work with so many communities around the country, one of the things that I run into is I know what information I'm looking for when my client says, well, it's at our website. And I know what keywords to search for if I can't easily find it at their website. If you can convince your local agency, get willcounty.org/green or willcounty.org/recycle or willcountygreen.org. Buy something that is very cheap to have extra. It can go directly to the URL that is this long that's part of the county website. But if it's difficult for people to find you, same with your Facebook moniker, they're not going to keep looking. They're not interested enough in what we all, as much as I think this is the most interesting field in the world, most people aren't interested in that. And then take pictures. Pictures with faces of people are, I think it's 3 times as much time will be given to that photo. So have your photos help give you that message. And we're talking about seconds. We're talking about 1 second versus 3 or 4 seconds versus 9. But have those photos help tell your story. And also think about the demographics of your community when you're selecting photos. So you shouldn't generally have photos that are all Caucasian people. So and be sensitive to the demographics of your own community as you're selecting. And as I said, be specific with numbers. And a specific number is always more meaningful to people, even though you think, to say we collected 2,442 pounds, wouldn't it just be better to say we collected over 2,000? Actually, no. If you look at the research, it is far more meaningful to people if you give the exact number. Now, don't give it down to the eighth decimal point. They really don't care about that. But a specific number is going to be taken much more seriously because they assume, for one thing, it wasn't an estimate and that it was the real number. So whether that's we had 72 people come or we had 382 cars come through during the day, again, that's a way to create social mobility. And then check everything, which seems like something I would need to remind people, but it often is. Check your list, check your links. If you're, especially if you're producing something electronically, make sure that everything you are asking them to click on actually works. Because if it doesn't, again, you lose them. And then check your math. If you're going to give a list of what you collected, for instance, at a household hazardous waste event, and you're listing things, make sure that the numbers add up, because there's going to be one person who adds those up, and then they call you and they say, you said this was 1,423 pounds. And those numbers do not add up. And then you have reduced your credibility. And then remember, again, social media is just a new kid on the block. We've been using multiple methods for years, you pointed out. Telephone calls, face-to-face, print, radio. We've been using multiple methods of communicating with people forever. This is just a new way to do it. Pick one. Yeah, Tumblr has, with a certain nature, I've been to Tumblr a few times, but pick something you can maintain and maintain it. And then once you get to the point where you think, wow, I'm maintaining that really well, then add something. I mean, don't